When you're watching a movie or reading a novel, it's always cool when two or three apparently completely unrelated plot threads come together and make sense. And that's happened to me in terms of these videos, because over the last few weeks, we've been looking at memory management, we've been looking at C-sharp 9 records, and we've been looking at the flyweight pattern. And in fact, all three of those things come together with the concept of string interning, which is something that's been around for a long time, right since the beginning of C#, but it's quite a useful feature to understand. And again, it's one of these things, although it doesn't make too much difference when you're programming, it can improve performance if you use it in exactly the right way. So let's take a look at some code. And what I've got here is just a simple empty program. And if we consider strings, there's something I've kind of brushed over when we've been looking at memory management, because strings are slightly special. The two things that are special about strings are, firstly, that they are immutable. So if I just type string s1 equals hello, and then take a look at the methods available on there, we've got things like to lower, to upper, trim, trim end, all that sort of thing. But the point about all of those is they don't actually modify the string that we've got in S1. They generate another string. So we would have to say something like string S2 equals S1.toLower. Or indeed, what you'll sometimes see is simply S1 equals S1.toLower. Still not modifying the string, it's just creating a brand new string, but just reusing the variable S1. So the fact they're immutable is one distinctive feature of strings. And then the other thing about them is that they use value comparison. So if I say string S2 equals hello, and then we just compare those, so S1 double equals S2, then we're going to get those as true, because even though they're different strings, they have the same value. And those two features are in fact exactly what we get when we're dealing with records. So if we look here at point, here I declared a record called point, just has a couple of coordinates. But the thing about that is it's all generated for us automatically. But if I create a couple of points with the same value, then again, we have the fact that I can only, for example, read X and Y, it's get init, there's no setter on there. But also, if I here do a comparison of P1 double equals P2, then we also get that true. Again, it's doing value comparison. And although strings aren't actually records, because they've been around in the language since before records were part of it, that's nothing particularly special. A record is just a convenience. We could write a class and simply enforce those rules for ourselves, that it has value comparison and that it is immutable. But records do it for us. So that's what we've got there. But one thing we can do, if we don't want to do this value comparison, we've always got available in C# the ability to force a reference comparison. And that's a static method on the object, the universal base class, called reference equals. And so if I do a reference equals of P1, P2, then it'll ignore the definition of double equals and equals that have been put in there, and it will just compare the references. And so we'll see in that last one, we're getting false, because although P1 and P2 have the same value, they have different references, they're different objects, and so that comes out as false. You'll just notice we don't really need that object because we're inside the class program, which is derived from objects. Static methods are available to us anyway, so we can miss that off. So what if we did the same thing with our two strings? So let's just get rid of the point code for a moment. There we're doing the value comparison, but if we did a reference comparison of S1 and S2, then you might think, well, they're different objects, they're going to give us false there. But in fact, we can see we get true. And that is down to string interning. And string interning is simply the application of the flyweight pattern specifically to strings within .NET, entirely done automatically for us when we create those two strings. So we've created two strings, both called hello. There's no point in having separate objects for them because they're never going to change because they're immutable. And so that's what we have. And so that's why when we create those two hello strings, we get the reference equals to be the same object. And in situations like this, where we're actually hard coding our strings, it's handled automatically for us by the compiler. It sets all that up. If we start manipulating strings in a slightly more dynamic way, then the compiler can't always keep up. So for example, if I were to do this, if I were to have S2 equal to world, and then S3 equal to S1 plus S2, then we would see that if I now try to compare S3 with hello world, then although the hard-coded one is interned, S3 is not interned, and so we'll see that although the value comparison comes out true, the reference comparison comes out false, because it's had to create S3 on the fly, and it doesn't automatically put it into the flyweight pool that it's using for this. If we were to make those say const, then that gives the compiler a better chance. And so now we can see we're getting true on both. Or if you want to, you can force interning at runtime simply by using the string.intern method. And what that does is it takes the created string, S1 plus S2, looks to see if there's a match in the flyweight pool that we're using, and then if there is one, it returns the previously interned one. Or if there's not, it will just put the string we've created into the flyweight pool. So now we'll see that on that one, we're getting true and true. So that's something you can do at runtime to make something intern. Another thing we can do, actually, is we can do the reverse of that, which is quite a weird thing to do. So suppose I'd said just here, S3 equals hello world. Well, that means that that will be interned, and therefore every reference the compiler can see will be the same object. So we can see we get true there on both. But if I wanted to, I could say string.copy, and that deliberately gives me a separate object. It does not use the flyweight pool that we have here. And so in that case, we get false on that second one. But you can see that copy is actually deprecated. It was never really a brilliant idea. Occasionally it could be useful if you were going to start doing some unsafe code and doing unmanaged manipulation of the string, but as of .NET Core, that doesn't work at all, so it's just deprecated. We shouldn't do it, and it's hard to imagine many reasons in normal programming why you might want to do that. Another thing we can do, though, is we can actually test to see whether a particular string is interned. So if I just take that back to the simple S1 plus S2, and then what I could actually do is say string.isInterned, and it will then have a look to see if there is a hello world already in the string pool. What it will then do is it doesn't return a bool, even though the name might suggest that, it returns the interned string. So if I were to just print off S3 there, then we can see that we're getting hello world coming back, and we're also getting true on both of those. And the reason it is interned is, even though it's happening later in the program, because the compiler's done this work, so the hello world is already in there. If I were to comment both of those out, what we'll now find is, let's just put not found on there if it's null. So now it'll return null because there is no other hello world in the string pool. And so we're getting not found there, but as soon as we reintroduce one of these, it finds it and it gives us that. So that's really what we've got with string interning. It happens automatically if the compiler can manage it. We can test for it with isInterned. We can bypass it, but we never should, with copy. And we can also just put something into the pool with the string.intern method. Obviously, all of this is really about performance. And there's actually two possible ways you can get performance gains here. One is in terms of memory. Obviously, if you've got lots and lots of uses of the same string, then it's better to have just one copy rather than lots in memory. But in fact, the main benefit comes in performance for comparison. Because if we consider the double equals we've got there, if there is a good possibility that that string has been interned, then actually the quickest way to discover whether they're the same object is just to use the reference equals, because that's just got to compare the addresses to find out if they're the same thing. So a trick that is hidden away inside that double equals, the very first thing it checks for is to see whether these are actually the same object. So it does a reference equals. And only if they're not the same object does it need to go through the slower process of genuine value comparison to see if they've got the same value, even though they're different objects. And so that's really where you get your saving, because a reference comparison, comparing addresses, is far quicker than a value comparison that ultimately may have to go through character by character. So as with every performance issue, it depends on circumstances, but I've got here just a quick little class to demonstrate that, where we've got this test, and basically I have two strings exactly the same, both 'twas brillig and the slidy toves. I then do a two upper. That's simply a way of making sure they're not interned. I could have done the string.copy, but we said that's deprecated. But two upper, because it's happening at runtime, has to return a new string, and it's not automatically going to be interned. I then run that through this get string, and all get string does is looks at this flag intern and either interns the string or just returns the non-intern string. So that's our source and our target. And then all I do is just loop through a billion times and do a comparison with the double equals. So that's the value-based comparison. But as we said, it can take advantage by first doing a reference comparison. And if a reference comparison is true, then it doesn't have to waste time on anything else. So we do that, we print out a count, and then we also time that so we can see the result in milliseconds for how long it took to do these billion comparisons. And so let's go back to the main program and let's just put in a performance P1 and we'll set the interning on that one to false. And then we'll have P2 and we'll set that to true. And then we'll just run the test on P1 and P2. Notice I've built this in release mode, only fair when you're doing performance comparisons because you don't know what's going to happen in debug. And when we run that, takes a little while, but what we'll see is that without interning, it's taken 5.8 seconds. With interning, it's taken 1.8 seconds. So quite a difference there. And that comes from the speed of that double equals, because just there, on the interned version, it finds that they're equal just by comparing the memory addresses, doesn't have to go any further. So that looked like quite a good performance improvement. The thing to watch out for, though, although it gives you a performance improvement when they are equal, if they're not equal, it doesn't really help at all. So if I just change one of those and run the same thing, we will see that it takes roughly the same time, but also it takes roughly the same time for both of them, because the point here is if those don't match, then they will have different addresses. So having got different addresses, they could still have the same value, and therefore it has to do the slow test in either circumstance. So whether it's interned or not, it has to do the slower genuine value comparison if they're not equal. But if they are equal, it can just get away with the reference comparison. So whether that's going to improve your program's performance, as ever, depends very much on the detail. So you've really got to have a think about it and experiment. But I hope you found that useful. It's a subtle, hidden away feature of C#, but it is worth knowing what's going on. So I hope you enjoyed that. If you did, do click the like button, do subscribe, and I'll see you next time.